still to this day, Dr. King's words still echoing in my mind and in my heart, that Sunday morning is the most segregated hour in America. This means that white supremacy, racism, and other isms still permeate in today's American Christian church. We attend it in the rhetoric, evident in the most recent voting results of our recent presidential election. Abram Extendi, the author of the book, How to Be an Anti-West Racist, put it this way. To be anti-racist is a radical choice in the face of history, requiring the radical reorientation of our consciousness. So, fundamentally, I think what Andy is trying to say is that saying I'm not racist is not the same as saying I am anti-racist. There are inherently differences there between the two. There is a contrast between the two. The first statement is passive, and it's a term that primarily is embedded in the Bible. Many have claimed to be not racist, even those that are considered to be racist, right? White supremacists, segregationists, those who support policies that reproduce racial inequities, they all say we're not racist. However, for one to say I am anti-racist, now that is an active statement, a term of radical reorientation, a term of consciousness that sees nothing wrong with racial groups and that supports policies that yield racial equity. So, I think my belief is that we should all be striving to not just be non-racist, but to be anti-racist. Now, these 9 years, we spend a lot of time talking about these kinds of things, processing, visiting other churches, dialoguing with other pastors about the necessity for multi-ethnic and intersectional churches, including intersection and gender, and identity and sexual preference in other intersections. These were people from Brazil, from Peru, from Palestine, from Philippines, from Guatemala, from Europe. We were the small embodiment of God's diversity of humanity, all gathered in this little world. And we agree that the multi-ethnic and intersectional church that worships Christ in unity across all racial and ethnic and gender and identity rights is the most visible sign of God's kingdom, the most visible sign of God's story of love. Asking a lot of things, and so I spend a lot of time talking about people and talking about our leaders and about our ministry team, about our congregation. And I talk to them about our children and youth, about our elders in the church. We are, listen to this, the multi-ethnic and intersectional church. We are the antidote to racism and white supremacy and homophobia, transphobia, and sexism, and xenophobia. We are truly striving to be an anti-racist community. Because we acknowledge our differences. We acknowledge our diversity. We acknowledge our distinctions. But in doing so, we choose to reject hate. We choose to reject segregation, to reject the othering of our neighbor. And instead, we choose to build up spiritual muscles to hold and care for one another in love. I just came back being the promised pastor of the Jesus. You should know that the ELCA is very powerful in this congregation. I mean, this was the executive circle. They are aware of the things we are doing, and you should be very proud to be part of this church. We are a vortex, a glimpse, an opening, a hint of the heavenly church. And yet, there is much work to do. Hear me when I say that the blessing of God, that the goodness of God, does not give us permission to sit around comfortably. It does not give us permission to be so cavalier is why I love the wisdom of today. Psalm 93. It sets into motion a rudimentary understanding of our human assurance that it originates in the divine, that the earth and all that is within it belongs to the Creator, who set the world firmly in place, and therefore it cannot be shaken. This is the good news, by the way, that we need to hear today. Because at times our world seems fragile. At times our world seems like it is at the brink of falling apart. But in His wisdom, it reminds us not so. The Creator of this whole world holds it together. It will not be shaken because our God is faithful all the time. Now that is sweet, poetic news. There is a similar motif in the scene we encounter in John's Gospel as well. The narrative that unfolds in the Praetorium, in the residence of Pilate, the Roman Gentile governor of Judea, who is hearing accusations from the religious leaders about Jesus, against Jesus, and what is effectively occurring is Jesus' trial. Pilate is forced to make a judgment call on the life of Jesus. Without his authority, the Jewish leaders could not proceed with their punishment. And certainly, when one reads the entire sequence, politics comes into play, and Pilate is coerced into approving Jesus' crucifixion. Now, it may seem to us that the Jewish leaders and the Roman leaders have the power. But truly, if you pay attention, the power is in Jesus' hands. Although more than capable, he does not fight back. Non-violence is embodied as protest, and in doing so, offers the potent political and spiritual message to listen to this, that the blessing, that the goodness of God, that the reign of God, it does not sit around silent, and it does not sit around inactive or arrogant. Rather, it speaks prophetically with courage. And it does not avoid conflict. In fact, what it does, it confronts conflict so quickly. It does not take away life, but rather it gives away life. And it does not avoid death by others, but rather it newly tries. Thus, the central motive is not whether or not Jesus is king. Instead, it is the message that the world belongs to Jesus too. That the things operate around and according to the power of Jesus that holds the world together, it will not be shaken, and its news is so needed for today. In our relationships, in our marriages, in our partnerships, we need this kind of wisdom. Conversations with our children, with our youth, with our grandchildren, with our neighbors, it is needed in our churches and our congregations, it is needed in our political talk, in our identity talk, our trends and God holds the world together, and shall not be shaken. It is also knowledge for vulnerable people, stressing out about the looming U.S. administration. To my clear and frank siblings, to my migrant and immigrant siblings, to my black and brown siblings, to my women siblings, I say to you, I see you, and I hear you. I also acknowledge the working class, the needy, and the ones who are weak, the ones who are living from paycheck to paycheck, those in financial distress, trying to make ends meet, challenged by the high cost of living, the high cost of the daily basic needs like groceries and gasoline and childcare and housing, especially here in Hawaii. I say you, I see you, and I hear you. The struggle is real, the burden is real. For those taking the brunt of the burden today, I come to remind you, I come to preach to you. God sees you, God hears you, God is with you. this way. How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Give justice to the weak and the orphan. Maintain the right of the lowly and the destitute. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. See, that promise is for all of us. Justice is coming. Rescue and deliverance is coming. My siblings, just hold on. Just hold on. Your day of liberation is coming. Now, some of you, which is some, will say, that all sounds so beautiful, Pastor Moses. But all we see is the falsehood in the lie. All we see is the injustice and the genocide of innocent people. All we see is the inhumane treatment of black and brown lives, of API lives, of queer and trans lives. All we hear about is the mass deportation of migrant and immigrant lives, families to be separated, treated like trash, all because they seek a more just human life. If that is you, this moment to choose to see the goodness in Jesus, to see and assume the righteousness and innocence of Jesus, to deny his crucifixion and his death, but instead he chose himself over his neighbor. Self-preservation over world preservation. It is not what many do today to other human beings. They assume the worst. They embrace the false narrative and act upon their fears. They choose economics over human dignity. They choose belonging over morals and ethics. They choose alignment of power and wealth over alignment with the Jesus way. They choose barrels and deny Jesus. Thank you.